We are going live in 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Good evening. I'm Bill Maley, Brighton Supervisor, and I'm pleased to welcome you here to the May 27, 2015 meeting of the Brighton Town Board. And I welcome you whether you're one of the people here in the auditorium tonight for the meeting, or whether you're watching us at home or wherever you may be on your computer or on your TV through our cable TV access channel. We welcome your viewership and we encourage your participation. In just a minute, we'll be going into our open forum where people have an opportunity to participate in the meeting, whether or not you're here in the room. So we'll be getting to that in just a moment. I do want to note before we get started, I'll get to that in a moment. In case of an emergency, you will hear the town hall emergency alarm system activated. If that alarm goes off, please exit this auditorium immediately, either through the door marked with the exit sign to my right, turn right, go down the stairs and out the rear door of town hall and away from the building, or through the two doors in the back of this room marked with the exit signs, out the front door of town hall, down the stairs, and again, away from the building. We don't expect that to happen, but just in case, we want everybody to be prepared. Occasionally, there technical difficulties may arise during the live broadcast of this meeting. If that should happen, if you should lose volume or picture, and you're watching on cable, please contact Time Warner at 756-5000. That's 756-5000. We'll now start with a pledge to the flag, and I'll ask Town Board Member Jim Vogel, please, to lead us.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I also want to mention that if you're here in the room, the full packet of tonight's meeting, all backup material, all agenda items, and the agenda itself are on the table in the rear of the room in the folder. Please help yourself to take a look at that. If you're watching on the internet or on TV, you can go to the Town of Brighton website at townofbrighton.org. And again, all those materials are there. Now, I do want to point out we have a couple of larger files that are included as part of tonight's agenda. So if you're looking for those on your computer, they are here in person in the back of the room. But for the information that has been submitted and will be received tonight relating to the proposed Clover Lanes Whole Foods project, that is included in the online meeting packet and agenda in part one. Tonight's meeting agenda on our webpage has two parts. After tonight, after we formally receive the documents, it will also be included on a page on the town's website entitled Private Development Projects, where we put relevant documents relating to any significant development project being considered in the town. So that's one. We also have the University of Rochester incentive zoning proposal is before us tonight, being considered for final approval. That material is included in part two of our online packet. All the material that we've received from the university is also available on that private development projects page. And finally, we also have a proposed amended incentive zoning proposal relating to the reserve from Costello Development. That material is also found in part two of the online agenda. And after tonight's meeting, that will also be added to the material that's already there relating to the reserve in the private development project section online. So I just want to make sure everybody can get to those documents if you'd like to follow along with us tonight. All right, now we will go to the open forum, a portion of the agenda. And as always, the open forum is an opportunity for people in the community to participate in the meeting. If you're here, you can raise your hand, we'll call on you, and you can make a comment at the podium here. If you do that, please state your name and address, if you would. Please direct any comments you may have to the town board and not to other members of the audience. Please be courteous and please try to keep your comments as concise as possible. And I would also note that if you're speaking from written comments or if you have any written material that you would like to have included in the written record of this meeting, you may do so simply by handing those materials to our town clerk, Dan Amon. Now, if you're at home, you can also participate in the open forum by calling 303-3060. So someone will take your question, your comment, and pass them on to the board. That number is 303-3060. If you are deaf or if you are hearing impaired, you may call our TDD line to participate in the open forum. The town's TDD line is 784-5205. Again, for TDD participation in the open forum, our TDD number, 784-5205. And again, you can address the board about any matter, whether or not it is on our agenda this evening. So we'll now begin the open forum. Is there anyone that would like to address the town board during our open forum this evening? Yes. Either one of you, come on up. Welcome.
My name is Camille Haupt. I reside at 26 Whitestone Lane, Rochester, New York, 14618. didn't really prepare anything tonight, but I just wanted to speak briefly to the Clover Lanes redevelopment project. I'm a member of the community across the street in the Shoreham Whitestone Lane neighborhood. And I know you've heard several people speak, but I think I just wanted to kind of add is I have three children and we live on a corner house and they play in the yard and sometimes shouldn't be in the street, but sometimes they run across the street. I guess a main concern that I have is increased traffic, which I know you've heard about before. I think I have a small concern that people would use that neighborhood as a kind of a cut through if that intersection at Allen's Creek and Clover would get too busy. I think they would, going over to 441, potentially use our neighborhood as a cut through. We do see some traffic that you can tell are using that neighborhood as a cut through, and they obviously go faster, and maybe there would be discussions about speed bumps, but we bought the house 3 years ago, my husband and I, just because of the community, of close-knit community. It's kind of a walking community. We walk a lot up to the neighborhood at Starbucks. And I think the project of that size would just change the whole atmosphere, I guess. So I'm not opposed, anyone can develop their own property. I just, if you're gonna give variances to something that's that big, maybe discuss something that maybe just a smaller magnitude within the variances that are allowed. So that's it.
Thank you. Did you want to, please?
My name is Sarah Vigiani from 104 Shoreham Drive. I'm also part of the Clover Downs neighborhood. I know you've had many people in here and speak, and I moved to Brighton, I think, mostly because of the close-knit community, that you was a walkable community. We don't have over in Shoreham Drive like 12 corners, but I've heard so much about the Monroe Corridor and how we're going to make it walkable and bicycle-friendly. And with this development coming in, I have such a concern for our families that are coming in, their families, like Ms. Haupt has just said, the scale and the access that you're putting right there, it just concerns me so much for me and my family. And I hope you all will take into consideration what you're going to be doing to our little community over there. You know, we've heard people say, oh, it's just you guys over there. But Brighton's a huge community, and I think we talk about how Brighton cares about our community. And I hope you will take into consideration our whole neighborhood. I mean, everyone is very concerned about the cars coming through and the safety of our children. I can tell you, since I moved there 3.5 years ago, the amount of children that are on the street, and we just want to keep the safety of them in our community. And I know I'm repeating myself again, but the scale of this Clover redevelopment is just way too big for the Monroe corridor. So I really hope you will take into consideration hear our voices and our concerns about this. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else that would like to address the board this evening during the open forum? If not, I just want to just speak briefly and sort of give you and everybody else that's watching an update on the process as it relates to that proposal. Tonight you will see as one of the first items of new business an action relating to the proposal. We remain in early stages of the review of that process. We have received from the developer what is denominated as an amended letter of intent, although I think we're treating that as really an amended incentive zoning application. It comes with a supplemental state environmental review report relating to SEQR, the State Environmental Quality Review Act. There are two documents in particular that I would call people's attention to. And again, as I mentioned earlier, this material is in the online agenda tonight as part of part one, and it will also be on our private development projects page once we formally receive it at tonight's meeting. There is included in there a long form, what's called an EAF, an environmental assessment form, and there was also a traffic study prepared by SRF Associates, and those are some significant documents that will be relevant not only to those of you watching, but they're critical documents as we begin the review process of this proposal. As you know, we have received the planning board advisory report, which is part of our review process whenever we get an incentive zoning project. In that advisory report, it included a recommendation that the town engage a traffic consultant as well to review the traffic study material, and that is certainly something that I'm in full concurrence with. That's something that will be paid for by the developer, but that will be a consultant that will report to the town. And I think that's an important part of our review process. if you've taken a chance to begin to look at this traffic study that is in here, it can get very dense with data. And having a trained consultant is very important in terms of communicating to us what all that data means. Data not only concerning current traffic conditions in the area, but also the impact of a proposed development. So that's part of what we're doing tonight. We're receiving, and just again, that it's a binder this size, so it is a lot of material, but it's very relevant, very important. We are also going to be authorizing Ramsey Boehner, our town planner, and Ramsey is here tonight, to coordinate the environmental review under SEQR and to seek lead agency status under SEQR for the town. So all of those items are matters that we are proposing to take tonight. Again, front end, early, before we get into the substantive review of the proposal, it's important that we go through these preliminary steps, and so that's where we're planning on being tonight. Again, as I've said before, we are a long ways from any final substantive approval or non-approval of this project. We will conduct a full environmental review that will include open public hearing, one or more open public hearings, I anticipate a public scoping process. And then, and only after that environmental process is completed, will we be in a position to consider the actual substance of the approval of the project. So I hope that gives everybody a better sense of where we're at. We will try to do that periodically just to keep people in the loop. Is there anyone else that would like to address the board during our open forum? I would note, by the way, we do have two public hearings tonight. One is an extension to the Brighton Consolidated Sewer District for property located at 59 Collingsworth Drive. Another is an extension to the Westerlo Avenue Refuse District for property located at 116 Westerlo Avenue. And if anybody is here to address either one of those public hearings and you would like your comments on the public record, I would encourage you to wait until we call those hearings. They will be coming up very shortly, and we will consider them at that time. But if there's no one else for the open forum, I would ask for a motion to approve tonight's agenda.
So moved.
Second.
Please call the roll.
Councilmember Vogel?
Aye.
Councilmember Novros? Councilmember DePonzio?
Aye.
Councilmember Werner?
Aye.
Supervisor Mealy?
Aye. Next we'll go to are these public hearings scheduled for 7:30?
The June 10th is the first one, so we changed the time.
We'll start the public hearings in about 10 minutes at 7:30. I'll then go to communications, ask for a motion to receive and file the communications we have tonight.
So moved.
Second.
We do have several items of communication relating to the proposed Whole Foods development project, and we will continue to receive and file those, whether you send them by traditional mail or by email. I will say it's, you know, it's somewhat more convenient when we get them by email, but we will receive them in either form, and we will make every effort to respond to all of those letters as we proceed. We also have draft 2015 action plan for Monroe County. Final comments are due on that document. I believe June 6th is the date. So if you have a chance to review that and have any thoughts, please share them with me so that we can submit anything. Any other comments on any of these items of communication? Hearing none, Dan, please call the roll.
Councilmember Vogel?
Aye.
Councilmember Novros?
Aye.
Councilmember DePonzio?
Aye.
Councilmember Werner?
Aye.
Supervisor Mealy?
Aye. Committee reports, Louise, Parks, Recreation, and Community Services.
Parks, Recreation, and Community Services has met. However, I don't have the minutes with me, so I haven't been able to prepare a statement yet. So I will do that at the next meeting. I do have a statement, though, that I'd like to read. About clean sweep, can I go up there?
Or at your place is fine.
This is a report on clean sweep, which we held last weekend. The participation in this year's clean sweep was tremendous. If you came to town hall at 9 o'clock, people were already lined up from the front door all the way to Elmwood Avenue. To measure how many people came to clean sweep, I took the number of t-shirts we had on hand when we started that morning and subtracted what were left at the end of the day. We started with 590 t-shirts and were left with 116. So we had at least a minimum of 474 people participate. Some didn't take shirts, and so I am comfortable to say that we had close to 500 people. Everyone enjoyed donuts, bagels, and cream cheese, orange juice, and coffee, thanks to Bagelland, Tops, and Starbucks. That was at 9 o'clock here. The school kids who met at their schools also had bagels and I think some donuts, but not from us. And they had other things, other breakfast foods as well. Cub Scouts, Boy Scouts, Brownies, Girl Scouts, church groups, Brighton Central School Children's Service Organizations such as Rotary, Kiwanis, and the Chamber of Commerce, neighborhood associations, and lots of moms and dads and kids of all ages participated in cleaning the town and then came to French Road Elementary School at noon for a wonderful lunch, thanks to Wegmans, who provided subs, Mark's, who provided pizza, and Great Harvest, who gave us desserts. None of this could have happened without four key people who were there with me every step of the way. Annette Hallahan and Heather Howell, who were, I asked them to come and they didn't want to be in the limelight, so they're not here. Annette did everything that I did and helped out. Heather was the liaison between the town and the school district. Becky Cotter was our computer person, and she's from the rec department and was also a huge help and overall helper. And Marianne Husser, always there for suggestions, helping on the logistics, and so overseeing town hall for us. I can't thank them enough for all of their work and support. And okay, done with that, there's one more event coming up. This Saturday at 9 o'clock at the Highway Department's Ops Center, right? That we're going to have our electronics and recycling and our paper shredding. And I know that's going to be very, very busy because I have been getting 10 or 12 calls a day since it appeared in the paper last Saturday. And the basic question is, where at Town Hall is it? It's not that we haven't had it before, but it's I have to tell them exactly where to show up and the times. And then they want to know if you have to be from Brighton. Preferable, but no, you don't. I tell them I don't check passports. So they people from all over are coming to that too, and I hope that we have a big turnout for that as well. Thank you.
Thanks, Louise. 1941 Elmwood Avenue is the address of the Highway Ops Center. And again, as we have done for so many years, and Louise recites the number of tons, it's a staggering number in tons when you convert it into thousands and thousands. You know, well over 100,000 pounds of material that we've taken in since the program began. And just again, we've got electronics. We also have document shredding. Documents will be shredded right there on site. In both cases, it's drive-through. You may not even have to leave your car. If you've got both, that's okay. You take two laps through, and it is a great, great program. And of course, the reason that the program was started, and really kudos, Louise didn't pat herself on the back, but I will, because Louise really organizes all of these events. And the reason, of course, was, it's a service to people, you know, especially in the springtime, spring cleaning, but it's obviously a tremendous environmental impact as we keep tons of particularly the electronics out of the waste stream, the shredded paper. Takes care of your privacy, but again, it also, that paper is recycled. So great, great work. 9 to noon.
9 to noon. One of the first questions that keeps coming up, will we take refrigerators or will we are not taking any huge appliances, but we're not gonna be taking anything that has Freon in it. People wanna know if they could bring their old humidifiers in or other kinds of things that may have Freon in it. They won't take those. And yes, we have over 80 tons of electronics that we've collected and about 60 tons of paper to date. So,
but you will take TVs?
We will take TVs at no charge, which is another thing they ask because I guess some places are charging you for that now.
And you do take microwaves, but no other appliances.
Right, just the small things, you know, the coffee maker or their telephones or radios that they'll take, but not the big appliances, stoves, refrigerators, that kind of thing.
Thanks, Louise, and I'll second your thanks to Annette, to Heather, Marianne, and Becky. You're a great team, and thank you for all that, the work you do. Finance and Administrative Services, Chris?
Met last Tuesday, May 19th. The matters discussed are on this evening's agenda, with the exception only of our preliminary discussion on replacement of an ambulance with the Ambulance Corps, and they're going to come back and report to us in detail on those. Our next meeting will be next Tuesday, June the 2nd, at 3:30 in the stage conference room behind us, and the public is welcome to attend.
Thank you. Jason, Public Safety Committee?
Yes, the Public Safety Committee met on May 12th, and a couple of the items that were discussed, one item of actual old business that the town board voted on back in the fall was the installation of the 25-mile-an-hour signs in the Monroe Meadows neighborhood, as well as over in the Doncaster, Furlong, Sylvia, and Southland, Doncaster, Furlong, and Sylvia neighborhood, yes. And some of the signs over in the Doncaster neighborhood were installed earlier in the month. And I believe the Monroe Meadows signs have been installed since our meeting. I was over in that neck of the woods over by Irving and Orchard over the weekend, and I did see the 25-mile-an-hour sign in place. So those items are all set. The other item that was discussed, and this is an item of ongoing business, is the limitation of pedestrian access to the railroad tracks behind the Clover and Greenaway neighborhoods. And also not only limiting pedestrian access, but also formalizing enforcement. That's going to remain on the agenda for continued discussions. And the date and time of our next meeting will be on Tuesday, June 9th. We meet at 8 o'clock in the morning. We meet in the lower level community meeting room, and the public is invited to attend.
Thanks, Jason. Jim?
Public Works will meet next Tuesday, June 2nd, at 9 o'clock in the lower level community meeting room. We have not had a meeting since our last town council meeting.
Thank you. We'll go back now to the public hearings. It is 7:30. And again, we have two of them. On the sanitary sewer item, I will ask the clerk, has the necessarily legal notice been given in this matter?
Yes, notice was published in the May 14th edition of the Brighton Pittsburgh Post.
Thank you. I then declare this public hearing to be open, and I'll ask our Commissioner of Public Works, Tim Keefe, for a brief synopsis of the proposed action.
Supervisor, I'd be glad to, as you have before you for a property up on Collingsworth, the property in question has a septic system that has failed. It's imperative that they are able to connect to the sanitary sewer. Sewer was recently installed within the last few years in Penfield that they will be tying into, and thankfully they have an option. The replacement of any septic system nowadays is very expensive. We always encourage folks to get onto the public sewers when possible, so this is actually a very good very good thing for them to do.
Thanks, Tim. Is there anyone here in the audience that would like to address this public hearing? Any comments or questions? Any comments or questions from the board? I would just note again, as Tim indicated, and I'll talk a little more later, sometimes these intergovernmental cooperation efforts save the town money. Here's an example of intergovernmental efforts really saving a resident money, because the closest sewer line is a Penfield line, and it's not a unique situation. There are a couple of these between the town of Brighton and Penfield and the town of Brighton and Henrietta. These residents are going to be able to connect to that line in Penfield as part of an intergovernmental agreement we have with the town of Penfield, and it will be much cheaper than connecting to the closest line that is in the town of Brighton. So anything further from anyone? Then I declare this public hearing to be closed, and I'd ask for a motion to approve this proposed extension.
So moved.
Second.
And again, of course, that motion is in the form that you have in your packet prepared by the attorney to the town. Any comments? By the way, the public hearing is closed. If I didn't say that, it is.
Yep.
Dan, please call the roll.
Councilmember Vogel.
Aye.
Councilmember Novros?
Aye.
Councilmember DePonzio?
Aye.
Councilmember Werner?
Aye.
Supervisor Maley?
Aye. And now we will conduct the public hearing on the second matter, the extension to the Westerlow Avenue Refuse District. And I'll again ask the town clerk, has the necessary legal notice been published in this matter?
This notice was also published in the May 14th edition of the Brighton Pittsburgh Post.
Thank you.
I should say, additionally, it's on the website. There's a slide on cable 12. On the
bulletin
board. The bulletin boards.
Great, thank you. Notice having been given, I declare this public hearing to be open. And again, I'll ask Commissioner Keefe to just a brief summary of
Thanks, Supervisor. When this refuse district was originally formed, it did not include this parcel, which is immediately contiguous to the refuse district. I don't know if it was an oversight on the neighborhood.
It's a corner parcel, right?
Right, it's a corner parcel, and I believe it fronts on South Clintonville. And I think that may be why it was overlooked at the time, assuming that it was a Clinton Avenue property and not a Westerlo property, but it's actually the reverse. And it's a good opportunity for that property owner to take advantage of being in a refuse district, which is much more economical than if you were to have private collection services that you contract on your own. So again, this is a fairly straightforward request, and it makes sense, and there's really no impediments to, from a logistical standpoint, from having this parcel come into the district.
Great, thank you. Is there anyone here that would like to address the board on this proposed refuse district extension? Any comments from the board?
No.
Hearing none, then I declare this public hearing to be closed, and can I have a motion to consider a resolution on the proposed extension?
So moved.
Second.
Again, a motion in form prepared by the town attorney. Further comments? Please call the roll.
Councilmember Vogel?
Aye.
Councilmember Novros?
Aye.
Councilmember DePonzio?
Aye.
Councilmember Werner?
Aye.
Supervisor Malley?
Aye. Thank you, Tim. We'll now move on to new business, reading and approval of the claims. Chris?
Bill, tonight I've reviewed claims totaling $714,411.79. Of those that caught my eye, I see we had insurance premiums for health insurance of some $275,000, by far the largest. Unleaded and diesel fuel, some $28,000. Background checks, some $60 that Dan Amon and the rec department are completing. The library has books of some $13,000 and a cost share arrangement with Monroe County library system there, some $28,000. Again, example of our intergovernmental cooperation. One that I guess I have a particular interest in was a workshop attended by the rec department for Silver Surfers. Folks my age learning to learn how to operate a computer and such. And also a large item, and I think very significant, is in the police department. We have three new police interceptors for some $89,000 that the police department just took delivery on. With this, though, Bill, I find the claims to be in order, and I move that they be approved for payment.
Second.
You know, we go through this process every meeting, and I think it's important for the community to know that, you know, this is one of the steps we take to make sure that all governmental expenditures have been reviewed and reviewed again. They're reviewed internally by our finance staff, led by Suzanne Zaso, but as required by law, the town board conducts this additional review before I sign off on them, along with other members of the board. So this is an important part of the process, and I thank you, Chris, for as finance chair, for your part.
As you do, it's a real education.
And I think it's an education. I say that because, you know, people sometimes wonder about the cost of government, and certainly it's not inexpensive, but you know the types of expenditures that the town makes, I think, are when itemized, as you just did and as you do every meeting, you get a sense for the breadth and the depth of the work that our various departments are engaged in, and the necessary expenses of doing that. So we have a motion and a second to read on the approval of the claims. Any further discussion? Please call the roll.
Councilmember Vogel?
Aye.
Councilmember Novros?
Aye.
Councilmember DePonzio?
Aye.
Councilmember Werner?
Aye.
Supervisor Malley?
Aye. Jim?
The next item is to receive and file the amended letter of intent along with the supplemental state environmental review report dated May 15th, 2015, relating to the redevelopment of Clover Lanes project, and authorize Ramsey Boehner, our senior town planner, to coordinate the environmental review seek lead agency status on behalf of the town board. I move on the resolution as prepared by the attorney to the town.
Second.
Discussion. Again, this is the matter that I described earlier in terms of the update as to where we're at in this approval process. And I say approval process, I don't mean to prejudge that a project will or won't be approved, obviously. Any further comments? Dan, please call the roll.
Councilmember Vogel.
Aye.
Councilmember Novros.
Aye.
Councilmember DePonzio.
Aye.
Councilmember Werner.
Aye.
Supervisor Mailey.
Aye. Chris.
Bill, the next item is the zoning and incentive zoning application from the University of Rochester for the institutional plan development project with authorization for the supervisor to execute all associated documents and agreements. I move that we adopt the resolution as prepared by the attorney for the town.
Second.
In the resolution that is coming before us is a thumbnail sketch of the history of this development. I won't go through all of the details because they are here and available, but this is a project that has gone through many, many years of review, review by town staff, review by the neighborhoods. I do want to commend the university. This is a project that initiated frankly, long before I became supervisor, but as the university went through some long-range planning, it wasn't their top priority. Shortly after I was took office as supervisor, the university indicated a renewed interest in moving forward with the project. They very willingly acknowledged the need to once again engage the neighborhood in the process because their awareness and ours that this is a very special part of town with a lot of tradition, but very, very importantly, some natural features of significance, drainage issues of real significance. And therefore the university engaged that process in both informal meetings with the public as well as formal public hearings. Those public hearings have been conducted over time. It has now been closed. You have before you a packet of a resolution that also has a packet of materials, including a proposed institutional plan development district regulations that will govern the use of the facility, really in a sense superseding some of the provisions of our town code, although many of those provisions continue to be applicable. Very importantly to us and very important to the incentive zoning process is the fact that there is an amenity agreement. Incentive zoning is a process under which a developer acknowledges the need for certain incentives. In other words, permission, approval from the town to do things that are not necessarily allowed under the code as it stands. And in return, the developer, in this case the university, provides amenities, a proposal of amenities to the community to offset the impact of that. And that's been a process that has been engaged in following the completion of the environmental review of this process, and the amenity agreement, which is attached to your resolution, I believe as Schedule D, contains the amenities that are being provided by the university. They include a series of drainage improvements that the university has committed to front end. That was an important factor. The university heard a great deal at these meetings from the public and from town staff the importance of doing what they can not only to offset what will be some negative drainage impacts of this project. There always are when there's significant development adding a lot of impervious surface, but also addressing existing, pre-existing issues with drainage. It's a low-lying area. Red Creek and other tributaries run through the neighborhood. And so they agreed to front end some of those improvements. They agreed that they would not take access onto Crittenden Road. There was concern as to access on Crittenden Road and negative impact on that neighborhood. That's been addressed. Any concern with emergency access was addressed by a proposed emergency access. They committed to donate over 40 acres of land to the town. That land is adjacent to Stowell Nature Preserve, an existing town park, and it will be a valuable addition to our town's park system. They agreed to buffering as an amenity above and beyond what the code already requires. And very significantly, they agreed to a cash amenity payment. And as agreed to, that is an amenity that is generally computed initially at a basis of 45 cents per square foot of approved building, constructed, you know, C of O opened building space. That 45 cents a square foot is indexed for inflation. And that will again help enable the town to provide infrastructure and other necessary services in the community. So that's the broad outline of the proposal. We have a motion and a second to consider this. Are there any comments from members of the board or questions? I will note that the university's representatives are here this evening, and we thank you for being here.
No, Bill, I think you summarized them very well, and it's been a pleasure working with the university to the extent they've been responsive to the community's comments and concerns. I think the amenities are significant. The 42 and a half acres that's been added to the Stowell Conservancy is really, I think, dramatic. And also, they've made every effort to minimize the impact on that neighborhood over there. The most important one being to the neighbors is that drainage. That water has been an issue in that section of town, and those improvements are going to go in right away, and I think we'll see the benefit of it. So I think this is an example of a development that is good for the developer, the university, which of course is a very important part of our community, but as importantly, it's going to be an enhancement to that neighborhood. That's our hope, and I think the mutual hope here.
I think the university has demonstrated very excellent approach to being a good neighbor with the residents in West Brighton and therefore the town of Brighton, and being the largest employer in the county, that says a lot, and look forward to working with you as the time goes on here and doing this thing in a good, forthright manner, which we've been working with you all along, and look forward to it. So
I'd also like to thank the university for their efforts with community outreach, scheduling the public hearings over at the old St. Agnes High School, reaching out to neighbors in order to keep everybody informed as far as the project is concerned. This is something to be very esoteric because it's a forward-looking plan for many years in advance. We don't know exactly what's going in there, but I think that these regulations and the university's drawings really shed a lot of light on what the vision is going forward. And the fact that with each of these pieces are being developed, it'll come back for planning board review, and it'll be continued input from the town and the neighbors. But I think this was on all, even though it was a long time, but I think it's going to be a good project going forward.
My turn. I too am very thrilled with the way that you have stepped up and taken each of our suggestions or our suggestions and came up with answers, and that everything has been on a very amicable basis. I think that the people in West Brighton have to remember, just as you have said, this is a very long range plan. It's going to be 25 to 50 years, and this town board will not address some of the issues that come up in 40 years, but some town board will, and the people have to stay vigilant as well as the people in government here to make sure that all of your hard work and our hard work has will pay off in the way we want it to. Thank you.
That's a great set of comments, Louise. I couldn't agree with you more. And I think, you know, we've thanked the university, but I also want to make sure a huge amount of thanks go to the residents in the neighborhoods surrounding this project. They have gone, delved into the materials. They live with the drainage issues on a day-to-day basis. They haven't been shy about expressing those concerns. And as I think it's true, neighborhood input, public comment, serves to improve. I believe this is an incentive zoning project, and I believe that this is going to be another very important, very significant, successful use of incentive zoning in the town of Brighton. We've used incentive zoning in the past to acquire parkland, to develop parkland, and for a number of other community goals, and this project, I believe, will be no exception. But sometimes the process, I know, seems challenging. Jose, you've done a masterful job. I know you've got a lot of constituencies at the university that you have worked with and worked with us and the whole team, Ron Papraki and all of you that have been engaged in this process. But what the neighbors have done is I believe, through their input, made what appears to be a project that makes sense both for the university and for the future growth of not only the town of Brighton but the Rochester metropolitan area a better project. As I'm saluting and thanking the university, I'm also thanking the folks in two neighborhoods, in that Helen Norman Bastion neighborhood and in the Southland Doncaster neighborhood over there.
And Bill, I want to make sure that we don't leave out Ramsey and Ken.
Yeah, absolutely.
Who have worked even over the holiday weekends that we've had these past couple of years, that they've done a fantastic job.
And others in their
department. But we got everything in a very timely manner each time you were going to come up before the board, so thank you, all of you.
I think with all the discussion we've had so far, it might help for the general public's information. The first phase of this project is a very important one about this imaging center, and I think it'd be helpful if one of the representatives from the university would come up and just explain again, briefly, what this first phase is all about. It's rather important, especially in the advancement of our medical capabilities in this community. It's very, very important. All you have to do is talk to a few of the physicians who have been eagerly awaiting this.
Jose, how are you?
Good. Jose Fernandez at 180 Heatherstone Lane. So the imaging building is intended to solve some latent issues within the medical center. In the medical center, we have both inpatient and outpatient imaging facilities that are decades old. And over time, the equipment needs just more space. So what we're finding is that we just need more space to be able to provide care, and we're constrained. The imaging building allows us to move the outpatient facilities to this building and allows us to expand inpatient services and right-size the room so that we can provide better care. And at the same time, what it does, it really enhances our ability to deliver services to people who just need to drive in to get an X-ray or an MRI. So rather than having to deal with going into the medical center, which is a very large and complex facility and, you know, difficult to park, and then you have to navigate your way through, and it can be really stressful to basically come to the hospital. For just a simple imaging procedure, you'll be able to go to this new facility, easily drive drive and park within a few steps of the front door, walk in, get your images, and be able to to go home. It'll be less stressful for people, and it'll provide some nice, straightforward, modern facilities and much easier wayfinding, because the distance from the front door to the waiting room will be probably about 20 feet, and the distance from the waiting room to the actual imaging equipment, just another 30 to 50 feet, as opposed to having to navigate hundreds and hundreds of feet in the medical center. So this will really simplify care and I think reduce stress that typically happens. You know, when people are going in for imaging, they're concerned, you know, do I have cancer? Is there another problem? And this is just going to help relieve stress.
Jose, is there going to be another smaller outpatient facility in that same building?
In the same building, we're also looking at a pediatric facility on the third floor, and again, that will provide services for children.
Thank you.
Great. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Any further comments? We have a motion and a second. Hearing none on a motion to approve the incentive zoning application from the University of Rochester for the South Campus Institutional Plan Development. Dan, please call the roll.
Councilmember Vogel.
Aye.
Councilmember Novros.
Aye.
Councilmember DePonzio.
Aye.
Councilmember Werner.
Aye.
Supervisor Mealy.
Aye. And I do note that there is a parallel review process concerning site plan review for the then imaging building that has begun and will continue. And once that process is through, that building will have the necessary approvals to move ahead. Okay, very good. Thank you. Next item, Jim.
Next item is to receive and file a Planning Board Advisory Report dated May 6th, 2015, and a letter dated May 19th, 2015, from Jerry Goldman, attorney of record for Anthony J. Costello & Son Development. This is with regard to an application to further amend the amended incentive zoning application for the project known as The Reserve, and set June 10th, 2015 as the public hearing date for the same. I move in the resolution as prepared by the attorney to the town.
Second.
Discussion.
Well, this item came forward with Public Works, but we have, set a public hearing there for June 10th and review this.
Yeah, I do want to. I, having been out to the project recently, it's certainly impressive to see how the units are going up and not only selling but are occupied. As you know, there has been an ongoing concern, and one of the reasons that we're going through this process, there has been a concern, and it's a concern I feel very strongly with the negative impact on property taxes for local municipalities of the condominium form of ownership. And this is a project that when it was originally approved a number of years ago, I think back in 2011 maybe, had a significant condominium component to it. That was a matter of some great discussion here at town board meetings with the previous town board. This proposal would involve continuing to stay below the number of condominium units that were allowed by that initial town board approval. It would reconfigure the project, removing some single-family homes and turning that small neighborhood in the overall project into condominium townhouses, which have sold very well in the project. The developer has yet to identify exactly how that is going to affect the loft buildings, because they've in general indicated that those condominium units are going to be taken out of the lofts. And they've posited a couple of ways that that might happen. One is to reduce the number of loft units simply by making the units larger. One is to eliminate a building altogether. They're looking at eliminating a total of 16 loft units. And one would be to, since there are generally four lofts on each floor, another option would be to take a floor off four of those loft buildings. I think it's important to note that on those units that have already sold, in general, they have sold at higher prices than were anticipated when the project was developed. And that's true both of the condominium units, but also of the relatively small number of single-family non-condominium units that have also sold. The projections that the developer submitted are based on an assumption that the loft units, the 16 loft units will, or at least one set of assumptions is based on the assumption that they would simply grow those loft units, make them bigger, and reduce the number that way. That would keep the square footage the same. I think it's going to be important that we have, you know, a true answer as to what the developer's proposal is going to be as we go through this public hearing review process. I also think it's important to note that although at this point the assessed valuation is running higher, or at least the sale prices are running higher than what was anticipated, based on the projections that the developer has submitted, there will be a significant, and by significant I mean seven-figure, reduction in the assessed valuation as opposed to the current configuration of the project. And that's going to be something that we, the community, and of course it's not just the town, that affects the school district as well. We're going to need to hear about that and talk about that. So I appreciate the fact that the backup data has been submitted, but that's something we're gonna need to take a very close look at through this public hearing process. I say that just to put this proposal in context, because it's a very important issue. I have publicly said that I believe that the state of New York should repeal the condominium property tax exemption, at the very least, for properties outside of New York City. The reasons that exclusion were put in place, number one, I believe generally no longer apply, and two, probably never did apply in most of upstate New York. So I'm sorry, Louise, go ahead.
It's okay, I just wanted to, in that regard, there was something in the paper the other day that a bill has been submitted in the state capital of New York to do away with that. And how would that affect this project or a project that is in the process of being built?
I think what you may be referring to relates to the 421A exemption, which is a New York City exemption. You may be right, though. I did not see it. If there is a proposal to eliminate the,
I think it was for the whole state. But
then. You know, we would. I, without having seen it, I don't know whether it's prospective or whether it would purport to apply to existing.
Yeah, does it apply to existing or does it apply to future? Does it? You know.
And would something like that pass? I don't know.
Phil, I note the matter on the agenda is to receive and file the planning board's advisory report on this, and I note the one They go through and recite the nature of the changes and such as you've summarized, but I do note that the one thing that the planning board noted was the benefit of the potential reduction in the number of loft units may have a positive effect on the view from the canal trail. So I think that reflects their approach and perhaps others of us that if we could knock a floor off of those lofts, that might benefit the view from the canal. That's might be one positive benefit of it particularly.
Although as of yet, I mean, I think you're right. You may be right, Chris, or the elimination of one of the buildings.
That also could impact
the view. But as of yet, I think it's important to note that as of yet, the developer has not committed as to how that reduction in units will take place, and those are two proposals, but their third proposal would be to keep the building size and make the units larger.
So, but I see that's the one that they particularly focused on, the potential reduction in size of those buildings.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Any further comments? Dan, please call the roll.
Councilmember Vogel.
Aye.
Councilmember Novros.
Aye.
Councilmember DePonzio?
Aye.
Councilmember Werner?
Aye.
Supervisor Mailey?
Aye. And I should have noted that the development team is also here in the room. Thank you for being here. next matter, Chris.
Bill, the next item is to authorize the supervisor to execute a membership agreement and any related documents to participate as a member of the Finger Lakes Municipal Health Insurance Trust. I move that we adopt the resolution as prepared by the attorney for the town.
Second.
Any comments?
Bill, we've discussed it at length. This is the opportunity the town has to join what's referred to as the consortium of municipalities that are insured under the health insurance plan of some 19 different communities.
I think
is that
we
correct?
Will be the yes. We will be the 18th or the 19th. Yes.
Yep. 17th. One of those. All right.
Mostly in Monroe County, but there are some in Ontario County as well. Yeah.
But the long-term expectation is that this is going to save a considerable amount of money for the town by going through this larger group. Yeah. It'll be a change in the insurance carrier for the town employees. But with fairly comparable, there's some differences, but comparable coverage and so forth. And although it does have a significant buy-in because we have not been a member of this group, so in the short term, it's not going to be a savings as much as the long-term benefit of this.
And I'll discuss, those savings and some other savings in a little bit, but you're absolutely right.
Yeah. Yep.
Anything further? We have motion and second. Dan, please call the roll.
Councilmember Vogel.
Aye.
Councilmember Novros.
Aye.
Councilmember DePonzio.
Aye.
Councilmember Werner.
Aye.
Supervisor Mailey.
Aye. Louise.
The next matter is for approval to accept a $537 donation from the Garden Lovers Club of Brighton to be used towards the planting of fruit trees on the grounds at Buckland House. I move on the resolution as proposed by the attorney to the town.
Second.
How many trees might this entail? Do you know, Tim? Just three.
Yeah.
Now, were there substantial orchards there at one time, or do we know?
I think so.
I believe that what have been put in, Chris, to recreate what the Buckland House used to have, in some semblance. And there was, I believe, a fruit orchard on the proximity of the property. This will add to it from the standpoint of the type of trees and what's already over there.
Are we going to be able to maintain and water and the rest of these?
Yeah, Bill, we'll have, typically we have the gator bags or the other watering devices that we will attach to the new planting so that they only have to be watered on a, like a weekly basis. This success rate is actually very good when we do that. And we do that with the trees we put in the right of way as well. So with the new trees, we do obviously take the care to ensure that once we plant them that their ability to survive is, are good.
Great, thank you. We have a motion and a second. Any further comments? Dan, please call the roll.
Councilmember Vogel?
Aye.
Councilmember Novros?
Aye.
Councilmember DePonzio?
Aye.
Councilmember Werner?
Aye.
Supervisor Mailey?
Aye. Jim?
Next item is to authorize the supervisor to execute an agreement with the BCS Smart Edge to provide HVAC materials and professional services. I move in the resolution as prepared by the attorney to the town.
Second.
Tim, if you could, just a little.
Certainly, Supervisor.
Context on this one?
Yes, I can. As my letter said, a few years back, we had some new control systems put in for the HVAC system that operates not only the administrative wing of the town hall, which is the town hall, but the public safety and the library wing. The original bid for doing this didn't include a period of time where the support services were included in the contract, in the bid. That has now expired, and we do need to have a service that can provide, or a company that can provide this service. It is proprietary, so we had looked at whether another company might be able to provide these same services, but they cannot. So we, you know, we have reviewed this. We recommend that Smart Edge, as the subsidiary of BCS, be enlisted to provide the services for us in this regard.
Thank you, Tim. Any further comments? Dan, please call the roll.
Councilmember Vogel?
Aye.
Councilmember Novros?
Aye.
Councilmember DePonzio?
Aye.
Councilmember Werner?
Aye.
Supervisor Maley?
Aye. Jason?
Yes, the next matter is to authorize the supervisor to execute agreement with Pipitone Mechanical Contracting Company to provide mechanical contracting materials and professional services. I move we adopt the resolution as prepared by the attorney to the town.
Second.
Tim, one more time.
I'd be happy to, Bill. Again, we have had a variety of mechanical contractors. Crosby Brownlee was the most recent prior to a recommendation for Pipitone. Crosby Brownlee is no longer on state or county bid, so we cannot take advantage of their services. We did authorize an agreement with them through June 1st earlier this year, just in the carryover period. And while we did our research, we were able to determine that Pipitone is on city contract. They helped us with one of our rooftop units a couple years ago, did a very good job. Mike, and at that time Kevin Hall, had very close interactions with them, and we sat them down again and talked with our new person, Steve Spencer, and Mike, and you know, so we feel comfortable moving forward with them in that capacity now.
Good, thank you. We have a motion and a second. Any further comments?
Anything to get the heat and AC fixed in this building, we greatly appreciate it.
Here, here.
76, 78 degree office every day.
That's a cool day.
Yeah, on the cool days, it's 76.
Please call the roll.
Councilmember Vogel?
Aye.
Councilmember Novros? Councilmember DePonzio?
Aye.
Councilmember Werner?
Aye.
Supervisor Maley?
Aye. Old buildings do have their challenges and quirks and their charms. This is a beautiful building. Louise.
The next matter is to authorize the supervisor to execute a County of Monroe Community Development Block Grants renewed agreements for sidewalk projects on Crittenden Road. I move on the resolution as prepared by the attorney to the town.
Second.
This will allow us to proceed with our community development grant funding for the construction of sidewalks along Crittenden Road, ultimately linking both Rustic Village and the Crittenden Way apartments to West Henrietta Road, transit. As of yesterday's announcement, chicken wings, and particularly linking the Applied Technology campus of MCC with the main Brighton campus of MCC. So these sidewalks, when we're able to complete them, are I think going to be very helpful in extending our pedestrian network in West Brighton.
Yeah, Bill, it's interesting when you see when people literally vote with their feet. You see the paths that are worn along the highway there, along on the shoulder of the road.
You're absolutely right.
These sidewalks are something that's really going to improve that mobility over there.
Very definitely.
We have a motion and a second. Dan, please call the roll.
Councilmember Vogel?
Aye.
Councilmember Novros?
Aye.
Councilmember DePonzio?
Aye.
Councilmember Werner?
Aye.
Supervisor Maley?
Aye. Matters of the supervisor, I do have a longer list than usual. Monday was Memorial Day, and as always, I appreciate the opportunity to honor and remember the men and women that have given the ultimate sacrifice for our nation. And having veterans there, including two veterans of the Battle of the Bulge, just heightens the impact of that day. But also what was important, I thought, that day is students, the kids, that are a part of Memorial Day, and that it really makes the history real for them. Music from the Crazy Pitches and Macapella from Brighton High School, Boy Scouts from Troop 152 posting the colors and sounding taps at the end of the ceremony really add to the ceremony, and I appreciate those students' involvement. Speaking of students, I had the opportunity to attend a ceremony honoring 12 Corners Middle School as a school to watch. That doesn't mean it's on a watch list. It means it's a school to watch because of the great things that they're doing over there. And it's certainly, we all know the Brighton Central School District, along with the other school districts that serve our community, is an award-winning district, and it was nice to see yet another recognition of the excellence of the school district that afternoon. The Brighton Farmers Market is now open outdoors for the season. We kicked it off this past Sunday. I think it's also important to note something else that we kicked off, and that is we've kicked off, as you may recall, we recently approved a contractor to prepare plans for a proposed winter farmers market facility at Buckland Park using some of the existing agricultural buildings on that site, with the logical connection to the farm history of that part of Brighton. That group met for the first time a week or so ago, and I'm very excited about the consultants that we have, who have a real history not only of farmers market work, but you know, municipal work in general. So that's going to be an exciting project. Although we have significant grant money at this point, we're still going to need to raise more money to make that project a reality. So, but it's great to see that effort continuing on. Again, talking about groups that deserve kudos, we all attend, or at least all of us elected officials, attended the Brighton Memorial Library Awards dinner this past week, recognizing both volunteers and staff for their excellence. Everybody that's been in the Brighton Memorial Library knows what an incredible facility is. I like to joke that the first year the county library system offered a contest to select Monroe County's best library, it won in such a landslide that they retired their uniform number. But it was really an overwhelming show of support for our great public library, and we were all pleased to be able to go out and thank those volunteers and our staff for the service and just for the way they interact with the people who use the library, as Chris alluded to. First, it's so much more than books now. You know, it's computers, it's iPads, it's music.
You know, Bill, the thing I noted, and keeping on topic here, was the fact that Brighton has the second highest circulation of any other library in the town. Second only to the town of Greece.
In the county.
Second only to the town of Greece, which has a population of roughly three times what Brighton is. So that tells you what an important resource our library is.
The last thing I want to note, and there will be a press conference tomorrow, the county and the towns and villages in Monroe County have spent the better part of this year identifying, qualifying savings from internal reorganization, from intermunicipal cooperation, from various sources to comply with the consolidation portion of the governor's tax freeze program. That was a requirement in this second year of the tax freeze program. And I'm pleased to say that, and this only applies, I think it's important to note, only applies to savings generated since January 1, 2012. Now, we have had savings. We've been working in an intermunicipal way with the city, with the town of Pittsford, with other communities in ways that have saved communities throughout the state through the NYMIR, New York Municipal Insurance Reciprocal, in ways that have saved us literally millions of dollars, but that have been in place since before 2012. But once we join the health insurance consortium that Chris referenced earlier, once we annualize those savings along with the other savings that we have generated just since January 1, 2012, from departmental reorganizations here in Town Hall, and from the reorganization of fire service in West Brighton, which has saved a significant amount of money while substantially enhancing the level of service available to residents of West Brighton, our annual savings will be over $500,000 a year. $500,000 a year that taxpayers are saving once the consortium is put in place and operating for a year. It is an indication, not that we're somehow smarter or anything else than the people that came before us, because their savings have been tremendous as well. It's an indication that we, you know, at the governor's direction, will continue to identify ways to work together to make government more efficient, more effective for you, the taxpayers. That's something we're concerned about every day. We're going to be starting in our budget process very shortly, and it doesn't get any easier. You're going to hear me say that a lot over the next 5 months, but it doesn't. And we have work to do. We found this $500,000. We're going to have to find more, but I know we're up to it, and we're going to keep working very hard. At the same time, doing what we can to maintain the high level of service that makes Brighton special. So I did want to note that, and that will be a media release on the part of all of the communities coming out tomorrow. That's all I have. Ken?
I have nothing.
Dan, matters of the clerk?
Nothing this evening.
Matters of the town board?
Bill, I had two items. One, I took the opportunity to walk about the community garden after the Memorial Day service and talked to a few folks with dirty hands and wet feet, I think, as they're watering things and planting things. And what a tremendous resource that is, and is fully subscribed. And it looks really terrific with the new fence that we put around there. But the fellow kind of laughed when I asked, was it keeping the critters out? And he said, nah, those rabbits are going to get at everything. They've all got their own internal boundaries and so forth. But it's really heavily subscribed there. And the question is how much more of that community garden type space we might have available to us over there at the Buckland Park once we see the comprehensive plan for the park. But that's something that's obviously used a lot. But the other thing is on a personal level. I sat with my dad on Memorial Day and toasted the one veteran we had at the table. He was the sole one. And he's 92 years old, and he's about to leave town. But when he heard veteran and thanked him for his service, he kind of smiled and held his hand up and pointed to his wrist. And he says, this, I got compliments of the German Army. And he showed the black piece of shrapnel still in his arm. That you can see beneath the skin. And it puts a personal understanding. It helps you understand a little better what it means to be a veteran and to have risked yourself. My dad, thankfully for me, did survive the war. And his recognition of the sacrifice of the Battle of the Bulge, veterans said that at the same time, it was the luckiest wound I could have gotten, because he recuperated from September through about January and missed the Battle of the Bulge, and then went in German the occupation forces in Germany. But the service of veterans, I'm very respectful of. I did not serve, and it takes a special person.
Indeed, thanks, Chris. Any other matters, Louise?
Yes, I just want to say that we approved to accept the $537 for fruit trees, and I was going to hold it hostage till I get what I want for the pool. But I just wanted to tell the people that have contacted me this past week about if we're going to get any shade at the pool, and I have been told that we will. We have to work out the details, and hopefully the grant money that was received for our Keep America Beautiful will be able to be used for that.
Good.
Good. Okay. Can I have a motion to go into executive session to discuss?
So moved.
Wait. He's going to say what it's for.
To discuss the employment of particular people and the purchase of real estate.
So moved.
Second.
Please call the roll.
Councilmember Vogel?
Aye.
Councilmember Novros?
Aye.
Councilmember DeFazio?
Aye.
Councilmember Werner?
Aye.
Supervisor Mailey?
Aye. Thank you, everybody, for watching tonight. We will not be coming back out into open session after this executive session. So have a good evening, and we'll see you at our next town board meeting, June 10th, 2015. Have a good evening.
It's raining now.
Thank you.